Today, Alaska is one of the richest U.S. states thanks to its abundance of natural resources as well as its vast expanse of pristine wilderness, its location as a window on Russia and a gateway to the Arctic. So what prompted Russia to withdraw from America? And how did it possess Alaska in the first place? Let's start from the basics on how Alaska was formed. Alaska was nothing for a while until all the dust of heaven started forming stars and planets. Our planet was formed around 4 or 5 billion years ago. Then at some point, continents mashed together and pulled apart several times. It obviously does, but it takes so long humans think it stopped happening. Anyhow, in all of this, Alaska began but had no people or animals or boundaries. Whatever land was there, now we call Alaska, is probably pretty different from now and then. Well, I'm explaining all of this because of the resources found there nowadays, and we'll get to that further on. Animals came onto America from Siberia across a part of Alaska that no longer exists. Animals also came from Africa, Europe, since all the continents were smashed together for a long while. After that, ice ages came and went for millions of years. At the time, Alaska was a giant block of ice about a mile high. This was tough on the animals, so they moved away. Eventually, the ice melted, and this allowed more animals to come to Alaska from Siberia. With that, some Siberians who were trying to eat animals followed them out of Siberia, and the next they knew, they were Alaskans. Let's fast forward a little bit now. That began to change in 1581 when Russia overran a Siberian territory known as Khanate of Siberia, which was controlled by a grandson of Genghis Khan. This key victory opened up Siberia, and within 60 years, the Russians were at the Pacific. The Russian advance across Siberia was fueled in part by the lucrative fur trade and a desire to expand Russian Orthodox Christian faith. Alaska remained unknown to most of the world until 1741, when explorer Vitus Bering arrived and claimed the land for Tsar. Russian fur trade soon began doing business there, but few stayed longer than necessary. In fact, no permanent colonial settlement would pop up until 1784, and there were never more than a few hundred Russians living in Alaska at any one time. Far from self-sufficient, the colony depended on native tribes, the British and the American, for supplies. The latter two of which, along with Spanish and French, had been exploring the area since 1700s. Eventually, Russian officials began to worry that US settlers would one day overrun Alaska, much as they did in Texas. These officials also feared losing the nearly defenseless colony to Great Britain, a naval power that had defeated Russia in Crimean War and left it ravaged by debt. But maintaining these settlements wasn't easy. Russians in Alaska, who numbered no more than 800 at their peak, faced the reality of being half a globe away from St. Petersburg, then the capital of the empire, making communications a key problem. Also, Alaska was too far north to allow significant agriculture and therefore unfavorable as a place to send large number of settlers. To top it off, the fur trade declined. Even Tsar's own brother called Alaska a luxury that Russia could ill afford. By the late 1850, Russia and United States had entered into negotiations over the sale of the territory. In Alaska, the Americans foresaw a potential for gold, fur, and fishers, as well as more trade with China and Japan. The Americans worried that England might try to establish a presence in the territory, and the acquisition of Alaska, it was believed, would help US become a Pacific power, and overall government was in an expansionist mode, backed by the then popular idea of manifest destiny. Wait, why Canada did not buy Alaska? It made perfect sense in 1867. Alaska was more naturally a part of British Empire. Canada, which was the naval superpower of the time, Russia would have been unable to defend Alaska in any conflict with the Great Britain. And if they were forced to cede it, their position in the Pacific would be further undermined relative to Britain, which already had an influence in China. The USA, on the other hand, was particularly non-entity in the international Pacific affairs at the time and posed little threat to Russia. In effect, Russia denied Alaska to Great Britain and created a weak buffer state. The scale also made it more likely that US would ally with Russia or remain neutral in international conflict. So a deal with incalculable geopolitical consequences was struck, and the Americans seemed to get quite a bargain for their $7.2 million. In other words, $7.2 million in 1867 is equivalent in purchasing power to about $127 million in 2020, a difference of a round figure of $120 million over 153 years. The 1867 inflation rate was -6.92%. Just in terms of wealth, the US gained about 370 million acres of mostly pristine wilderness, almost a third the size of European Union, including 220 million acres of what are now federal parks and wildlife refuges. Hundreds of billions of dollars in whale oil, copper, fur, gold, timber, fish, platinum, zinc, lead and petroleum have been produced in Alaska over the years, allowing the state to do without a sales tax or an income tax and give every resident an annual stipend. Alaska still likely has billions of barrels of oil reserves. The state is also a key part of United States defense system, with military bases located in Anchorage and Fairbanks, and is the country's only connection to the Arctic, which ensures it has a seat at the table as melting glaciers allow the exploration of region's significant resources. Nowadays, agriculture represents only a very small fraction of Alaskan economy. Agriculture production is primarily for consumption within the state. Manufacturing is limited, with most of the food and general goods imported from elsewhere. Alaska's main export product after oil and natural gas is seafood, salmon, cod, pollock, and crab. Let's go back in 2013 fishing season. Alaska fishers were able to accumulate a total of 5.8 billion pounds of seafood, which equates to an evaluation of 1.9 billion and increasing. With fewer than 800,000 residents, Alaska is the fourth least populous state in America. The Golden State boasts the largest economy in the US, with a gross state product of nearly $3 trillion. The state now has net assets of $76 billion, made mostly of $49 billion Alaska Permanent Fund. That makes every Alaskan worth a cool $103,000. But before you go buying that new home, remembering that the money won't be cashed out and showered on people. Something considered years ago while handling every Alaskan a $25,000 payout from the Permanent Fund. And while the state's $76 billion is a lot of money, it is less than the net worth of Bill Gates, which is about $1.5 billion. Oil production has set Alaska on the path to prosperity, and the production is failing. Yet Alaska has other resources it barely tapped into: its substantial mineral deposits, including coal, copper, zinc. Also important are increasingly rare earth elements such as europium, needed to produce red color in TVs and computer screens. There are 70 occurrences of rare earth elements in the state, including the Ray Mountains northwest of Livingwood, Buchan Mountains in the southeast. Alaska has just begun to study its mineral potential. Only 15% of the state's mineral resources have been properly mapped. Geographical surveys have been flown over only 25% of the 100 million acres the state owns, and I think we have barely scratched the surface in the mapping area. And who knows what other kind of mineral resources are available in that area which has not been touched by humanity. Shall we think that the Americans are smart and know what they are doing? Well, they made a pretty good deal with the Russians in buying Alaska. That's it for today. Have a great day ahead.